When I went to have my wig tightened, I mean, get a haircut the other week, my hairdresser was, shall we say, one of those kinds of people who looks different on the outside than they are on the inside, which is a common occurrence enough that it is something that we're taught about in the scriptures and warned about the fallacy of judging books by their covers. Now, it's something that we do all the time because sometimes the covers do tell you about the books. I remember that I was told that if people dress a certain way, it's usually because it's something that they like. If you are walking down the street and someone is wearing medieval armor, it's probably that they're into that time period of life. The kinds of costumes that we wear at Halloween tell people a lot about what our interests are or the things that are on our minds. But sometimes what's on the outside doesn't tell you about what's on the inside, or it tells you the wrong thing. I know from my own life, I have intentionally dressed myself up in ways that have been designed to, as a litmus test, to tell me more about the people than those things told them about me. I intentionally don't live an ostentatious life and drive a 25-year-old car, not because I can't afford one, but because what you think of the way I live, the way I dress, the way I look, and the car I drive tells me more about you than those things tell you about me. Now, for some of these things, like my hairdresser, they're a little bit more permanent, but even then, it doesn't tell you about their whole story, because we read in the book of Samuel, when the prophet Samuel is deciding on a new king, that the Lord sees people differently than we do, and we cannot just rely on what our eyes tell us to properly determine what a person is like. The reason why this is important is because in order to love our neighbor as ourselves, we need to be able to see them not as the world wants us to see them, but in the way that the Lord sees them. Because only when we see them that way can we honestly love them, pray for them, serve them, bless them, and invite them into the fold. Here's the reason why that matters. When I was serving as a missionary in the Vienna Fifth Ward in Floridsdorf, Austria, we brought an investigator from what's their Austrian equivalent of Section 8 housing in Wendelgasse to church one Sunday, and he stayed for the first two of the three-hour block that we had at the time, so sacrament meeting and Sunday school, and then he left before priesthood meeting started. And the bishop of the ward made a comment about basically disparaging him for and being grateful that he was gone. And Elder Hoos, the area authority 70 in the ward, told the bishop, if you're concerned about the kind of people that the missionaries are teaching, then you should not be surprised. Without your help as a member, they are going to find those who are humble as a consequence of their circumstances, just like the Book of Mormon teaches us. And if you want the missionaries to teach and baptize people in a different socioeconomic status, you need to introduce these elders to your friends. And I love Elder Hoos. It was like, good, I want to say that, but you're a 70 and I'm just a missionary and I'm, was I even 20 yet? No, I wasn't even 20 years old yet. So it's like, good on you. That's exactly what needed to be said. But sometimes I need to be reminded of that as well. Like when I was having my hair cut by this woman. She was definitely not what I expected on the outside. Tattoos, colored hair, which usually sells a particular story. But not always. She's not the only person. When I entered the MTC to become a missionary, there was this gentleman in my language group who was going to Dusseldorf, who I asked him, because we're there in like July, and he's always got his long sleeves on and they're all the way down. And I asked him one day finally, why don't you ever roll up your sleeves? Because we're outside walking and, you know, he's got to be hot and sweaty. And he said, when I was in the Marine Corps, I got tattoos because that's what everyone did. And when I joined the church, I didn't have them removed because it wasn't required. And it isn't, I get that. And they said I could go on a mission as long as I kept the tattoos covered. And I respect that. Because he was willing to be in a certain way where people weren't distracted by a different message. Because there's a lot of good people out there whose outward appearance distracts us from their message. When I worked for Walmart, my trainer was this stereotypical band dude, you know, and he had actually been in a grunge band, tattooed, pierced up the wazoo. And I wish I could remember his name because he was a really good guy. And he told me, he said, I got to the point, I was 30 years old, I had 3 kids and a mortgage, and I realized I needed to get serious and get a job and pay the bills. And so he had gone to work for Walmart. And at the time, that particular Walmart warehouse, I think he was making like $16 an hour, which was a respectable wage at the time, $30,000 a year, $32,000 between overtime and stuff, to where he had become the kind of person who was taking responsibility. But if you looked at him on the outside, you would not be able to tell. And I have to respect him for that. Because Samuel told the people, when he was choosing a new king, the Lord looketh not on the outward appearance, the Lord looketh on the heart. And he was looking for a person with a heart after the order of God. He was looking for people, good people, people who had good principles, people who were kind. And you can find these things in people no matter how they look. Stephen Hawking, for example, had a debilitating disease, but it did not mean he was in any way mentally diminished. He was also sort of funny. I remember there's an interview he gave where someone asked him after one of his theories came out, so you're telling me that there's a parallel universe where I'm smarter than you? And Stephen Hawking said, yes, and there's also one where you're funny. I think that's hilarious. It was a really good way to disarm the definite condescension of the interviewer. And so sometimes we make small choices that we carry with us forever. I have a scar here on my palm that you probably can't see because of the quality of the image that I got scuba diving in Hawaii. And it isn't because I did anything evil. I made a miscalculation in the tide and ended up on top of the reef. And in getting myself off the reef, I cut my palm open. And it's a reminder to me, something that people see. I also have one under here somewhere something that I didn't have anything to do with. I'm in organic chemistry, and they don't even let students do the Grignard replacement anymore, probably because of this. And you have to clean everything, and then it has to be completely dry before you start the reflux. And the girl, there was an empty workstation right next to me, and then the girl on the next one over from me had not dried her equipment properly and started the reflux, and it exploded everywhere. And I had glass sticking out of my face, a piece of which put a scar in my face here. It's really unsightly, one of the reasons I have a beard. She had facial reconstructive surgery, and I don't know exactly what happened to her. I did see her again, but she was bandaged up and stuff, and it totally changed her life. And I wonder sometimes about her more than myself, because she will carry those scars forever for a mistake that she made. And how do people judge her and look at her? And in the end, we're all like that. We all make mistakes. We all do things that we carry with us. And I've been divorced, and I will carry that with me for the rest of my life, because you can't get undivorced. There are things that no matter what we do, we can't erase them or run from our past. Convicted felons, people who have gone on social media and made donkeys out of themselves. The internet never forgets. Some of the users do, but the internet never forgets. I mentioned him before. I'll mention him again because he had a lot of good things to say. Elder Efencio Busha, who was in the area presidency when I was a missionary in the Europe West area, gave a speech once and said, if you cannot love a person, look into that person's eyes until you can find the hidden rudiments of the child of God within them. And I'll tell you what, it was really hard to do for some of the people that I met. I met some actual SS people as a missionary. I had some companions who were absolutely horrific to work with. And then there's been some other people in my life. I had the stepfather of a student I taught once who tried to destroy my life. I had a coworker who tried to destroy my life. And then, of course, I have an ex-wife who made some efforts years ago now. She's left me alone for a long time, and I'm grateful for that, who really set me back a great deal in my life. And it was hard because these were people who were using and abusing me to see the hidden rudiments of a child of God in them. And it was probably about 5 or 6 years ago that I was finally to a point in my life where I was willing and able to get down on my knees and pray for them and see them the way that God wants me to. Not to see them as he does, because I don't think that that's what he means. He wants us to see them as he wants us to see them. Because it's easy to see the pain they caused. That's the part that we remember. Someone really tries to screw with your life, you are going to have a hard time forgetting that no matter who you are. But there's something about them that's lovable, because Jesus suffered in Gethsemane for their sins as well. He was willing to bleed and die for them too. So there must be something in them that's redeemable, that's worthy, and that's valuable. I love in the introduction to the 1963 version of the Screwtape Letters that I have, C.S. Lewis writes a foreword in there, and in there he says, it's the reason I have that one in particular, he says, "I do not believe that if you take away all that is good in man, you are left with a bad man. I believe if you take away all that is good in man, you are left with nothing at all." Because we are all created in God's image, and God is good, ergo, if we exist, there must be some good in us. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoso believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life." Not just the people you like, not just the people you know, not just the people that you agree should be saved, but that whoso believeth in Christ and followeth him might have everlasting life. That's powerful. There's something in them. And so I came to a point where I was able to pray for them and say, "I don't know why you love them, but I know you do, because they're children of God too." And I was able to get down and honestly and earnestly pray for those who despitefully used me and persecuted me. And I was honest with the Lord, and I said, "I'm not praying for them to be, you know, prospered beyond me. But I pray for the portion of truth and the things to happen in their life that will bring them to thee." And I think that is consistent with his desire that we see other people the way he sees them. We have our own scars and weaknesses. Some of us have no limit to them. No matter how scarred you are, no matter what you've done, it is possible out there that somewhere there's a child or a dog that will love you. Even Adolf Hitler, and I hate to mention him, but he had dogs that loved him. I don't know why, but even Eva Braun, his girlfriend, complained that he had a better relationship with his dog sometimes than he had with her. So if a dog can love a fascist, genocidal maniac, and a dog can love you, God can love you, anyone. There must be something in him that was worthy of loving. Babies and puppies love unconditionally. I don't know why dogs love people. The only people they don't really like are people they don't know and people that are bad to them, the same way we are. Someone causes you pain and suffering, you're like, "I just don't really want to hang out with you anymore." And that's the usually the best case scenario. It's not like we're like, "Hey, come over to my birthday, beat me, kick me, it's okay." But there are dogs who will say, "Your slave is grateful for all marks of favor." And it's a weird and wonderful thing. And then there are children who love their parents despite the way their parents treat them. And so if children and dogs can love just about anyone, then it means we can too. It means there must be something in them. There must be a hidden rudiment of a child of God in every man, no matter who he is, even if he's someone you don't know, even if he's someone you don't like, even if he is someone that you've been taught, that you have been told they are absolutely convinced that that person is going to hell and cannot be redeemed. Who are you to decide that? I do not know where anyone is going, least of all myself. And if I were to know that, then I would probably be because I was already there. Christ was willing to suffer for Hitler too. Hitler may not care, but he was willing to do it for him anyway. Furthermore, we have been taught that with what judgment we judge, we shall be judged. So if we're judging others by the way they look, then we'll probably be judged by the way we look. And I don't know about you, I'm tired of being judged by the way I look, because I go and have my hair cut, and almost every time, because it's almost always a different person, like, "Wow, your hair is, is so thick and the color is beautiful. I don't know if you can tell, you probably can't, but I even had one who told me once, people would pay good money to have me color their hair the same way as you. And I said, that thanks, but no woman walks up to me and goes, wow, your hair is really pretty, do you want to go out? What they see is that I'm overweight or that I drive a 25-year-old car. And they're like, eh, pass. They judge me based on my outside appearance. And if we judge other people by their outside appearance, we can't be surprised when they judge us by ours or be upset. And if we're unwilling to see past their mistakes, how can we expect God to see past ours? And then finally, the third iteration of that is, if we can't forgive ourselves, God may not be able to judge us more mercifully than we were willing to judge ourselves. I don't know that for certain, but think about that. If you are willing to forgive yourself, that's important too. Because I want these to be backed up with actual scripture, I'm going to read some comments from Elder Uchtdorf's 2011 talk in the women's session of conference from the talk entitled Forget Me Not, because this is related and very powerful and much more poignantly iterated than I. And I wanted to share this with you. He says, we spend so much time and energy comparing ourselves to others, usually comparing our weaknesses to their strengths. This drives us to create expectations for ourselves that are impossible to meet. We never celebrate our good efforts because they seem to be less than what someone else does. Everyone has strengths and weaknesses. It is wonderful that you have strengths, and it is part of your mortal experiences that you have weaknesses. Skipping down. Many of you are endlessly compassionate and patient with the weaknesses of others. Please remember also to be compassionate and patient with yourself. God does not judge you on the outside. He does not compare his strengths to your weaknesses. He knows that you have weaknesses. He celebrates when you handle your strengths with humility. He rejoices when, because of your weaknesses, you draw to him. He loves that you are compassionate with and patient with others who make mistakes. He invites you to forgive yourself. I have grown up with mostly friends who are of other faiths. Yeah, almost exclusively. And many of them are reticent to share their weaknesses with me because they believe me to be some sort of paragon of righteousness. That's only because they just don't know what I do. I had a dog who knew everything about me, and he loved me anyway, like I said. They have all been surprised when I said, I need the Savior just as much as you do. And I was able and willing to forgive them. But sometimes I'm not willing to forgive myself. Part of that I know is the way my memory works. Part of it is the way I am. If you're one of those people who cannot forgive and forget, learn to forgive yourself. Here are a few scriptures. When Alma is talking to his sons, I think it's Corianton, in the Book of Mormon, he says, let your sins trouble you only with that trouble which will lead you to repentance. And in the Doctrine and Covenants, the Lord says to Joseph Smith, I, the Lord, will forgive whom I will forgive, but of you it is required to forgive every man, including yourself. That wasn't in the original. I, the Lord, will forgive whom I will forgive, and him is forgiven the same, and I, the Lord, remember them no more. And if God can remember your sins no more, how can you do any less for those who have repented, especially yourself? We will all carry scars for the rest of our lives. We will all make mistakes for the rest of our lives. But the greatest two mistakes that you can make in your life are refusing to let the Lord heal you and letting your mistakes make you. He suffered in Gethsemane and hung for a moment so that you would not have to if you let him. Learn to see other people the way he wants you to see them, as children of God who are worthy of the same sacrifice that you believe, that you talk about being worthy of. And learn to see yourself as worthy of that as well. Not that you blindly forgive yourself of every transgression and rebellion, but remember that he came to save everyone, not just those that you think are worthy, not just other people. He loves you too. So whatever people look like, wherever they be, whatever they've done, the atonement can save anyone from their sins who leaves them behind. There was a gentleman at our last fast and testimony meeting in the ward who was an investigator who's getting baptized ostensibly in a couple of weeks, who said, I'm looking forward to changing and becoming a better man. And that is the whole point. To turn your weaknesses into strengths, to be compassionate and patient with everyone, even those you don't know and don't like, and even in the times when you don't like yourself. I testify that the Savior's atonement, his sacrifice, his suffering, is for everyone, everyone who wants it. There may be some who choose not to avail themselves of the opportunity, who do not access the atoning power of Christ, and who will miss out on the blessings and the opportunities concomitant therewith. But I testify that for all of those who come, there is healing, there is refreshment, there is relief, there is joy. I challenge you to put in the effort to see people, to look for the good in people, to look for the good in yourself, and to only let your sins trouble you with that trouble that will lead you to repentance. I promise you that as you do so, you will have more joy in life, and that others will see the joy in you, and you will help, even if you never see how, in helping them change their lives and find more joy. This I testify in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.